Good morning, all of you. So, in today's class, we will talk about first law of thermodynamics applied to open systems. Okay, we can solve a couple of problems in closed systems also. But let me cover this first law applied to the open systems, and then we will go back and solve two or three problems in closed systems as well. Okay. So we will be dealing with the first law applied to the closed systems today. Sorry, open systems. Okay, so in the last two sessions, we have talked about the first law applied to the closed systems. And in today's session, we will talk about the first law applied to the open system. So when you say open system, you have both the mass transfer as well as energy transfer. In closed system, we restricted ourselves to the energy transfer alone. There was no mass transfer in case of a closed system. So now in an open system, you will have mass transfer as well, which means apart from the energy balance, which we saw energy in equal to energy out plus energy stored, now we have to check the mass balance also. So how much amount of mass is entering in, how much amount of mass is leaving out, and is there any mass stored inside the system? So you should take care of the mass balance also. So when the open system is taken into consideration, you have to have both the mass balance as well as the energy balance. Okay, we have already talked about an open system. So in an open system, you have got a precise control volume. That is, the boundary is fixed here. Your boundary is not going to change. The volume is not going to change. Okay, so the boundary would be this. So if this is the boundary, this boundary is not going to change at all. This boundary is not movable. This boundary is fixed. Okay. But at the inlet and the exit, so at the inlet and at the exit, it may be imaginary. That means there may be a hole there for the entry of the mass and the exit of the mass, but still that boundary is not going to move. The boundary is imaginary, the boundary may be imaginary, but still the boundary is fixed. Okay, so the control volume remains the same. This volume here, the example shown is a turbine, so the control volume of the turbine is not going to change. It is going to remain the same. Okay, and because it is bounded by a boundary which is not changing, we can call that as a control surface. The boundary can be called as a control surface. Okay, and the example shows that the entry is from the top and the exit is at the bottom. So some amount of mass is entering in, maybe you can call it as M1, and some amount of mass is leaving out, you can call it as M2. So there can be two conditions here. Either your M1 will be equal to M2, which means the mass entering the system is equal to mass leaving the system. Okay, so that is the usual condition that we take. The other condition could be M1 equal to M2. So some amount of mass has left, whereas some amount of mass is stored. Some amount of mass is stored inside the system. Okay, but in almost all the thermodynamic devices, we don't store any mass. If it is a turbine, certain amount of steam is going to enter in. It is going to give its enthalpy to the turbine in the form of mechanical energy, and it will leave out, all of it will leave out with a lesser enthalpy. Okay, nothing is going to be stored inside. Okay, so this stored is for the mass balance. So either you can have M1 equal to M2, or it would be M1 equal to M2 plus some amount of mass being stored. But in most of the cases, or in almost all the cases, none of the mass is stored inside. Everything is being sent away. Okay, so that is your open system. And you can see that the work is being done by the turbine, so I have shown work output. And the heat transfer could be either way around. Heat can enter into the system or it can leave the system. Usually, the turbine will be insulated, so there will not be any heat transfer at all in case of a real case turbine. Okay, heat loss may be there, but we want the turbine to be perfectly insulated. Okay, according to the first law, Q is equal to delta E plus W. So if you look at the open closed system, we neglected this kinetic energy term and the potential energy term because we were dealing with a cylinder piston arrangement. In a cylinder piston arrangement, there is no flow of mass. The mass remains the same. Okay. Whereas in this particular case of an open system, in case of a turbine, so your air or the steam may enter in with a higher velocity. Okay. And it may leave out with a lower velocity. The perfect example could be a nozzle. So if you have a nozzle, okay, the best example could be a convergent nozzle. So when something enters in with a velocity V1, the purpose of the nozzle is to increase the velocity. So you will have V2. And this V2 will be greater than V1. Okay, which means now the kinetic energy cannot be neglected. Now there is a variation in the velocity. In case of a cylinder piston arrangement, this kind of an increase in velocity is not there. It is very, even if it is there, it will be at the molecular level and that is negligible. Okay, whereas in this particular case of an open system, your kinetic energy cannot be neglected. If you take the example of this turbine that I have shown, you see the inlet is here. The level of the inlet is here. So if you take this particular level as the ground level, okay, say if I take this as the reference, this is the ground level zero. Okay, now you can see that the inlet is here. The inlet is at a distance, is at one from the ground. If you say this is the exit is at a distance, is at two from the ground. Now the variation is a little bit huge, right? For Z1 and Z2, the variation is there. Even for a turbine, it is very less. But for some other devices, if you take maybe a big tank, then the entry is at the top and the exit is at the bottom, then that particular potential energy difference cannot be neglected. Okay. So when there is a variation in this Z value, the height, with reference to the ground, then that cannot be neglected. So that is your potential energy. Okay, so in case of an open system, you can't neglect the kinetic energy and the potential energy. So apart from the internal energy, these two energies should also be taken into account. So Q equal to delta E plus W now becomes Q equal to delta EK plus delta EP plus delta U plus W. Okay, this is a very generic thing. So when we say delta EK, it will be V2 squared minus V1 squared by 2 per mass. Okay. EP would be GZ2 minus GZ1. Delta U will be U2 minus U1. So that difference will be there. So we can see how it needs to be worked out. Okay. So we have already talked about open system, and this is just a recap of what an open system is. Okay. And what we are going to deal now is a steady flow process. The word steady means something remains constant with time. Okay, steady means some parameter, some property, it remains constant with reference to time. That means even after 1 hour or 2 hours, that property is not going to change. That is called steady. Okay, a property remains constant with respect to time. So when I say steady flow, so that steady flow process, the process is going to take place with no variation with respect to time. Okay. So the rates of flow of mass and energy, mass flow rate and the energy flow rate across the control surface is constant. So m dot is constant. So that is what we saw in the previous slide. So in the previous slide, I told you either you can have m1 equal to m2 or you can have m1 equal to m2 plus mst. In this case, what we are saying is the rate of flow of mass is going to be constant, which means m1 dot is equal to m2 dot. Okay, m1 means simply mass. M1 is mass. When I divide it with time, it becomes M1 dot. Okay. So this m1 dot is not going to change with respect to time. When I say m1 dot by t, say 1 kilogram has passed this steady flow device in 1 second, or maybe 5 seconds. 1 kilogram of air has passed through the steady flow device in 5 seconds. So 1/5 is m dot. So 1/5 is 0.2, right? So 0.2 kilogram per second, that is the m dot. So m2 dot will also be 0.2 kilogram per second if the process is steady flow. If it is not steady flow, then that will be different. It can be 0.3 or it may be 0.1. It can't be 0.3, it can be 0.1 or 0.15. It can't be greater than m1 dot, it will be lesser than m1 dot. Okay, so it will be, this is the steady flow device that we are going to consider. So it's a very simple device, just like we did in the case of a turbine. Now we are doing it in a very generic sense. Okay, so this is the steady flow device. This rectangle which I have shown is the steady flow device. It has got an entry here on the left hand side and the exit on the right hand side. Okay, so the at the entry, m1 dot is the amount of mass that is entering into the steady flow device, and m2 dot is the amount of mass that is leaving this device. And you can see that the entry is at a height Z1 from the ground level. Exit is at the height Z2 from the ground level. Okay. And here you can see this device is doing some work, which means work is done by the system. The steady flow device does some work. So we have some work output, and that is shown as dW by dt. Okay. And here you have some heat entering into the system, so we call it as dQ by dt, which means heat addition takes place here. And you can see I have shown a simple shaft here, so there is a shaft work that is happening here. Okay, so it could be either a work input or a work output. Okay, so that means this device is connected with another device. It is like a motor generator arrangement. Your generator can run on, cannot run on its own. So you usually connect a generator with a motor. So whenever the motor shaft is connected with the generator shaft, so when the motor rotates, your generator is also going to rotate. So in a similar way, your steady flow device has got a shaft, and this can be attached with something else, okay, to start the rotation. So some amount of work is done here. So that is called the shaft work. So either your steady flow device can be used to run some other device, or the steady flow device takes work input from another device and it runs. Okay, either way, there is going to be a shaft work, and we call it as WS. Okay, so this is the arrangement. For this arrangement, we will do the mass balance as well as the energy balance. Okay, so because we have the mass balance, okay, as I told you, m dot in will be m dot out plus m dot stored. That will be the usual representation. Okay, but if m dot stored is equal to zero, that means when no mass is stored inside the device, okay, if no mass is stored inside the device, then m dot in is going to be equal to m dot out. Okay, in a steady flow, we say m dot is going to be constant. Okay, there is no variation in m dot. So we can write that m dot as a1 v1 by small v1. Okay, this A1 is the area at the inlet, V1 is the velocity at the inlet, this capital V, we usually use capital V for volume and small v for specific volume, but now here we use this V for velocity, so you should not get confused. This is area into velocity divided by specific volume, area into velocity divided by specific volume at the exit. So the unit for area is going to be meter square. For velocity, it is meter per second whole divided by meter cube per kilogram for specific volume. Okay, so you will be able to cancel out the meter cube in both the numerator and the denominator. You can cancel out this meter cube over here, and you will end up getting kilogram per second. Okay, so this kilogram per second is what we call it as m dot. m dot is nothing but mass divided by time. Mass is in kilogram, time is in second. So that is your m dot. So m dot in equal to m dot out. Or you can say rho 1 a 1 v 1. 1 by small v 1 is rho. Density is 1 by small v, 1 by specific volume. Specific volume is in meter cube per kilogram. So 1 by meter cube per kilogram will be kilogram per meter cube, which is the unit of density. So you can replace this small v1 with rho. Rho 1 a1 v1 equal to rho 2 a2 v2. And this mass balance is called as the continuity equation. It is called as the continuity equation. So when you go into further studies in courses like CFD, people will talk about continuity equation, momentum equation, and the energy equation. So in thermodynamics, we are dealing with the continuity equation as well as the energy equation. Momentum equation is nothing but your force balance. Okay, when you balance the forces, you end up getting momentum. Force is nothing but rate of change of momentum. So when you balance the forces in the system, you go for momentum balance. Okay, so in CFD, we will be dealing with three equations. In computational fluid dynamics, we will be dealing with three equations: continuity equation, momentum equation, and energy equation. Whereas now in thermodynamics, we are dealing with the continuity equation as well as the energy equation. Okay. And there is something called the flow work. Okay. This flow work is similar to your displacement work in the closed system. In a closed system, we have got the PDV work. You have the cylinder piston arrangement. And either the piston is doing some work on the gas trapped inside the cylinder, or the gas trapped inside the cylinder is doing some work on the piston. Okay. And we have derived this W equal to integral PdV. Okay. But now we are going to talk about something called a flow work. And this flow work, you can define this as PdV. Okay. But what we know here is, say, let us take an example of a compressor. Okay, we have a compressor here. And there is an entry to this compressor and there is an exit to this compressor. That means some amount of air is going to come in and some amount of air is going to leave out. Okay. Now for this compressor, there is a boundary and this boundary is fixed. We have already seen that this boundary is fixed here. And we call this boundary as the control surface. So let me call this as CS. C stands for compressor, C is for the control surface. And this volume inside the compressor is not going to change. It remains constant. So control volume. But if you take the example of a cylinder piston arrangement, the volume does not remain the same. Say initially the piston is here. So the gas trapped in the cylinder is there below this piston and it is in a compressed state. After a couple of time, you will find that the piston has moved to this particular position, to this dotted position. The piston has moved here, which means now the volume inside the cylinder has increased. It has gone from V1 to V2. In this particular case of an open system, you don't have a V1 or V2. So that is why there is no change in volume and we call it as a control volume. Okay, so when you say PdV, here there is no change in volume. The volume remains the same. Okay, so your dV will be equal to zero. So we can't use PdV here in the flow work. So we have to do a simple arrangement here. If you remember, we defined specific volume as capital V divided by M. That means volume divided by mass. So I can also write volume as small v into M, which is specific volume into mass. Okay. So I can replace this PdV as P times d of small v into m. Okay. The specific volume is also not going to change. Volume and specific volume. Specific volume means per kilogram. So that is also not going to change. So you can take this v outside the differentiation. So you will end up getting pv. What about the mass? Does the mass change? Yes, it does. Some amount of mass is entering in, some amount of mass is leaving out. And maybe after 5 minutes, more amount of mass is entering in and more amount of mass is leaving out. After 10 minutes, mass lesser than the initial mass is entering in and lesser mass is going out. So there is a variation in mass. So I can call this as dm. So instead of pdv, I can write this as pvdm. Okay. Because there is no change in the volume, the control volume remains the same. So we can't use dv. Dv will become zero. Then dw will be zero. But we know by experience that some amount of work is given as an input to the compressor. So you can't say dw is zero. There is some work being done. So we replace dv with vdm. Okay. And the flow work at the inlet, we call it as p1 v1 into dm1. So at the entry, what is the pressure of air? What is the specific volume of air that is entering in? And what is the mass of air that is entering in? Okay. At the exit, what is the pressure with which it is leaving out? What is the specific volume with which it is leaving out? And what is the mass that is leaving out? That is at the exit. Okay. And that is called as the flow work at the inlet and the flow work at the exit. Okay.
The specific volume would be same, no, sir?
Specific volume would be same. We can't say that. Why we can't say that is, while entering in, say suppose we will be doing a couple of examples on it. So it will be very clear at that point of time. So in a compressor, what happens is we have discussed this earlier also. If you take the example of a centrifugal compressor, I have said that there is an eye of the impeller. Okay, it is through this central part, air is sucked inside the compressor. Okay, and what I'm drawing is 2D, and you have to imagine this in 3D. Okay, okay, the impeller is actually rotating. When you switch on the motor, the impeller starts rotating. Your air has entered in through the eye of the impeller, and it now goes into the impeller. Okay. But the impeller is rotating. The air has entered in with lesser velocity. Okay. Now, because it has gone into the impeller is imparting its energy onto the fluid. Okay. So when it is imparting its energy onto the fluid, its velocity increases. The velocity of air increases here. It is transferring its energy to the air. Because it is rotating, it is transferring its energy to the air. Okay. And outside this impeller, there is something called a diffuser. And in this diffuser, what happens is they have an enlarged area. If you take the nozzle, in the previous case, I have shown you a nozzle. So in the nozzle, when the entry is large, the area at the entry is large, the area at the exit is small. So when the area is small, you can have more velocity. Okay, if you invert this nozzle, it will become a diffuser. That means your diffuser will look something like this. It will have a restricted area or a minimum area at the entry and maximum area at the exit. So what happens here is, in case of a nozzle, the pressure energy is converted into kinetic energy. Here, the kinetic energy is converted into pressure energy. The same thing happens here also. So what happens is, your velocity is getting converted into pressure. So what actually happens here is compression. So when you compress something, your volume will automatically get decreased. Okay. We are not talking about the volume of this particular thing, the volume of the control volume. We are not talking about the control volume. We are talking about the specific volume of the air, the condition of the air with which it has entered in and the condition of the air with which it is leaving out. Okay, so this specific volume will change slightly, but this control volume is not going to change. Are you able to understand the difference? We are not talking about the volume of this particular region of space. We are talking about the specific volume of the air that is entering in, and that variation is caused not by the region of space, that change is caused by the impartation of energy by the thermodynamic device. Okay, in this case, it is the impeller. It is imparting its energy. As it is imparting its energy, its pressure goes up and its specific volume comes down a little bit. And that variation is what we are taking into consideration. So is that clear to you?
Okay.
Okay. So that is the flow work at the exit. Okay. So now that flow work can be called as PV. Okay. So I should not call this as DW flow. It is simply W flow. W flow is PV. When we say DW, it should be PVDM. Okay. So W flow is PV. Work flow per unit mass is PV. Per unit mass. Or otherwise, it would be W flow would be PV into M. Okay. So this is work flow per unit mass. So we call it as PV. If it is workflow, it will be PV into M. Okay, so that is your flow work. So that is what we have in the open system. In the closed system, we call it as PDV. In the closed system, we call it as PDV. In the open system, we call it as PVDM. So that is called the flow work. And this flow work is because of the energy impartation either by the device on the fluid or by the fluid on the device. Now I have showed the example of compressor. The reverse thing happens in case of a turbine. In turbine, what happens is steam enters in with large amount of energy. So there the turbine is not rotating actually. So the steam makes the turbine to rotate. So depending upon the higher enthalpy it has, the more rotational energy will be imparted to the turbine. Okay. So there the energy is imparted by the fluid on the turbine. Whereas in a compressor, the impeller is imparting its energy to the fluid. Either way, it can happen. So that is what we call as the flow work. Okay. So that term we will be taking into consideration while we are doing the energy balance in case of an open system. Okay. So now we will talk about the energy balance. So for this, you should remember this particular diagram. So in this particular diagram, we have said that there is a steady flow device. At the entry, it is entering with M dot one. At the exit, certain amount of fluid is leaving with M dot two. Okay. And the height at the exit is Z two. At the entry, it is Z one. The work output is dW by dt. The heat input is dq by tt. And there is a shaft work. Okay. So this is the base. So remember this diagram. So it is based on this, we are going to do the energy balance. So what is the total work transfer? So there was a shaft work, right? So Wx is the shaft work, which means they are taking it as the work output. Okay, so it is a work output. So the total, among the total work output, dW by dt was the total work output. So among that, you have this Wx as the shaft work. Then you have this flow work at the inlet. Just now we saw how to do that. And the flow work at the exit. Why do we put a minus sign? So flow work at the inlet is in the form of work input. So we call it as minus P1 V1 D1. And here we have the work at the exit. So we call it as P2 V2 DM2. So work input is negative, work output is positive. Okay, so these are the three work terms that we have. You can make a note of it as I go from one equation to another equation. So what we are doing now is we are actually deriving something called steady flow energy equation, SFEE. So this is a very important derivation. So sometimes people ask this for 11 marks also. So steady flow energy equation. S for steady, F for flow, E for energy and the other E for equation, steady flow energy equation. Sometimes they ask you to derive the steady flow energy equation. So if they ask you to do that, then that is what we are doing right now. Okay, so the three work transfer terms that we have are the shaft work, flow work at the inlet, and flow work at the exit. So this we have written in this particular algebraic form. So if you do that in the rate form, that means when you divide it with time, dw by dt and is equal to dwx by dt. So dm1 by dt and dm2 by dt. So that is the rate form. Okay. So your dw by dt can be written as, so this dm1 by dt can be called as m dot 1, and this dm2 by dt you can call it as m dot 2. That is what we have done in the next equation, so you can call it as m dot 2.
Sir?
Yes
sir, could you please explain what is wx, sir?
Shaft work.
Okay, sir.
We told you, no, here there is a shaft work here, ws. So what this device is doing is, this device is supplying some work. It is like a turbine which is connected to a generator. Okay, in a normal electricity generation, what they do is they will connect the turbine to a generator. The shaft of the turbine will be connected to the shaft of the generator. So whenever the turbine rotates, the generator is also going to rotate. So the rotational energy of the turbine is getting converted into electricity. Okay, so that is the kind of work output this device is doing. So we are taking this WS as the work output. So that is the shaft work. Okay, WS is the shaft work. So that is that WS here, they are writing it as WX instead of S, it is X. That's all.
Okay, sir.
Yes?
Sir, why is P1, V1, DM1 the term negative?
That is at the inlet. So when some work is entering in, that will be taken as work input, right? So yes, something, sir, is entering into the system, so that is work input. So work input is always negative. Work output is positive. So we are taking P1, V1, DM1 because it is entering in, so that is negative. P2, V2, DM2, that is leaving the system, so that is positive, which is a work output. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so we can write this as dwx by dt minus p1 v1 m1 dot plus p2 v2 m2 dot. Guys, once again, remember this capital V stands for velocity. Okay, this capital V stands for velocity and small v stands for specific volume. Don't forget that. That is the point of confusion. Many students end up in steady flow energy equation, because we don't have any other variables to represent. Okay, V, capital V is for velocity and small v is for specific volume. And we also use capital V for volume, but that volume is not going to play a picture in case of an open system, because in an open system, volume remains constant. Okay, so now we can say, according to the first law, your dq is equal to dE plus dw. If you remember, that is the first law. The what the first law is telling us is dq is equal to dE plus dw. That is in the rate form. If you write it in the algebraic form, it is q is equal to delta u plus w. Delta u plus w. Sorry, not rate form, in the differential form. dq is dE plus dw. So in the differential form, when you write it, when you divide it by t, it becomes rate form. So dq by dt, dq by dt is equal to dE by dt plus dw by dt. Okay. And you will be able to easily identify this dq term and dw term. This dq by dt is here. This dw by dt is also here. Okay. And this dE by dt is written as E2 into dm2 by dt minus E1 into dm1 by dt. E1 into dm1 by dt. Okay, so this is the difference of the energy. So E2 minus E1. Okay, so this term, this negative term is taken to the left hand side as m1 dot E1. Sorry, here m1 dot E1. Okay, and this term is retained on the right hand side as m dot 2 E2. Okay, that is nothing but the difference in the energy. Okay, dE term, dE by dt term is written as m dot 2 E2 minus m dot 1 E1. Okay, so that is what is split up and written in the equation. Okay, and now in the next step, what we are doing is we are substituting this term dW by dt. Instead of dW by dt, we are substituting this whole term here, dWx by dt minus P1 V1 m dot 1 plus P2 V2 m dot 2. Okay, so this is what, this is the base equation that we get. Okay, and now this energy that we have simply written it as energy, and this we have already seen that energy comprises of the kinetic energy, the potential energy, and the internal energy. And now we are talking about specific energy, energy by mass, and that is why we are writing it as small e. Okay, so the specific energy is V squared by 2. If it is ME, that would be capital E, and here you will have MV squared by 2, that is the real kinetic energy. MGH, here we have MG, is it? M into U would be capital U. Because now we have divided it by mass everywhere, it becomes specific energy equal to V squared by 2, specific kinetic energy. G is a specific potential energy. Small u, specific internal energy. That is what we have. Okay. Now we are going to substitute the value of E in this particular equation. So m dot 1 into V1 squared by 2 plus Z1G plus U1. This guy is negative on the right hand side, so that is being pulled to the left hand side as positive, plus dq by t equal to m dot 2 into the energy term at the exit, plus the flow work at the exit, plus the shaft work. Okay. And now what we do is this p1 v1 into m dot 1, and here also we have an m dot 1. So we can combine them by taking m dot 1 as outside. Okay, we can take that out and we can merge these two terms, the first and second term. And you will get u1 plus p1 plus v1 squared by 2 plus z bunch. And u plus pv is h. So we replace it with h1 plus v1 squared by 2 plus g z1 plus dq by dt. The same way you can do it on the right hand side also. You can couple out these two terms and we can write it as H2 plus V2 squared by 2 plus Z2G plus dWx by dt. So this equation is what is called as the steady flow energy equation. Okay. So this equation is what is called as the steady flow energy equation. So you guys can write it. I'll give you a couple of minutes. You can write it down. This is very, very important. If you know how to derive this, because we will be solving a couple of problems in open systems also. Sometimes you get problems from open systems. And you need not memorize the last equation. You can simply derive this equation. You need not memorize it. And you can apply it for various thermodynamic devices and get the result instead of memorizing this particular equation. Okay. Yes.
Sir, in open system only shaft work is possible, sir. Are there any other form of work is possible?
Any other form could be additional. Instead
but
this
is a basic.
Shaft work is the very common work that we have. If you take compressor cannot run on its own. It requires a motor to run it. Okay, so the work input comes in the comes from the motor in the form of shaft work. If you take pump also, it requires a motor to run a pump. So there also you require work input in the form of shaft. For a fan you require a motor. So once again it comes in the form of shaft work. If you take turbine, you have work output. And even there, the work output has to be taken to the generator in the form of a shaft work. So in all these, in most of the thermodynamics devices, we have shaft work. So that is why we take that as shaft work. Other forms of work could be additional. Maybe if you have some electromagnetic induction, something like that, then that would be additional work that you can have. But shaft work is the common work that we see in most of the thermodynamic devices. That is why they write it as shaft work.
Yes.
Apart from shaft work, you can have other works also. That is permissible.
Yes.
Okay, so let's move on to the next slide. So the same equation. In the same equation, if you are going to divide it by dm by dt, that means if you are going to divide it by the mass flow rate. Okay, that is possible only when, that is possible only when m dot 1 is equal to m dot 2. Here we have said m dot 1 and m dot 2. So if m dot 1 is equal to m dot 2, then I can divide it by dm by dt. So if that happens, then I can cancel out this m dot 1 and m dot 2. But you have this dq by dt term also, so you have to divide that by dm by dt as well, and dwx by dt should also be divided by dm by dt. Okay, so when I say dividing by dm by dt, this is applicable only when m1 dot is equal to m2 dot. So only then we can, only then the equation will be reduced to this. So h1 plus v1 squared by 2 plus z1g plus dq by dm equal to h2 plus v2 squared by 2 plus z2g plus dwx by dm. So either it would be m dot into h1 plus v1 squared by 2 plus z1g plus dq by dt plus m dot into h2 plus v2 squared by 2 plus z2g plus dwx by dt, or it would be in this particular form. So either you can have this last equation in the rate form. So either you can have this last equation in the rate form. This equation is called as steady flow energy equation. This is in the rate form. That means dq by dt and dw by dt. Or you can have in this form also on a mass basis, per mass basis. You are dividing heat and work with mass. So you can write it as per mass basis also. So this is also steady flow energy equation, but in two different forms, that's all. Okay. So now if I simplify that, if I integrate that, then I will end up getting Q minus Wx equal to H2 minus H1 plus V2 squared minus V1 squared by 2 plus G into Z2 minus E Z1. And in the differential form, it can be written as dq minus dwx equal to dh plus vdv. This vdv is nothing but velocity. So when you integrate it, you will get Q minus Wx, and dh would be simply h2 minus h1, and this would become, when you integrate it, it will become v squared by 2. So you will again get v2 squared minus v1 squared by 2, and you will have g into z2 minus z1 when you integrate this equation. So this is in the algebraic form, and this is in the differential form. So if you integrate this differential form, you will get the previous equation. Okay, you will get this particular equation. So these are various forms of representing it, but the two equations which I have shown in the box, that is what we will be using in solving the problems. Okay, so those two equations you can be familiar with. This is just an extended version of your first law. Your first law is dq is equal to dE plus dw. Your dq is equal to dE plus dw. That is your first law. And applied to the open system, you can see that this dq is there on the left-hand side. this dw there is on the right hand side. The other term is de. So the de is what you find here as h2 plus b2 squared by 2 plus z2g minus h1 plus v1 squared by 2 plus z1g. So that difference is your de. So your de term now involves enthalpy, kinetic energy, and the potential energy. So if you are able to understand it in that way, then this equation is not hard. It is not something to memorize. It is very simple. You can just retain it in mind and you can very simply write down this equation. Okay, so this is the first law applied to the open system. And this equation is called as steady flow energy equation. Okay. Okay, right. Now what we have is, this steady flow energy equation can be applied to certain thermodynamic devices. And this is where you will be getting problems. They will give you the conditions for various thermodynamic devices and they will ask you to find out some other conditions. Okay. So now we are taking the example of a nozzle. I have already told you what a nozzle is. Okay. Now I'm taking a convergent nozzle, which means the area is reduced. Okay. And it is, let's say, air or some fluid. So let's say air. Air is entering with a lower velocity V1 and it is leaving out with a higher velocity V2. We have so many times discussed that the control volume of this nozzle is not going to change and the control surface of the nozzle is not going to change. So I'm not going to show that. We have done that so many times. And I'm pretty sure that you guys have understood that. Okay, what we see is the velocity has increased from V1 to V2, which means now your V2 is greater than V1. This is something which you should understand. So for a nozzle, the velocity at the exit is much higher than the velocity at the inlet. Okay, what other conditions I want to show here is this nozzle is perfectly insulated. There is no heat transfer in case of this nozzle. So even in the problem, unless or otherwise they mention about the heat loss, you should assume that for a nozzle, there is no heat transfer. Okay. But however, in a real scenario, there will be heat loss from a nozzle. Even if you have perfect insulation, there will be some amount of a heat loss. Okay. So when I say it is perfectly insulated, so your dQ by dm becomes zero. There is no heat transfer in case of a nozzle. And you can see for the nozzle, there is no shaft work. There is no shaft connected to a nozzle. There is one inlet and there is one exit. So some amount of fluid is going to enter in and some amount of flowing is going to go out. Because of the restricted area, your pressure energy gets converted into kinetic energy. So your kinetic energy is increased at the cost of the pressure of the fluid. Is that clear? Okay. So there is no shaft work here. Because there is no shaft work, the shaft work also becomes zero. Look at the entry. The entry is at the same height. Say if this is the reference, the ground level, if this is the ground level, if this is the ground level, you can see the entry is at the same height as that of the exit. The entry and exit are at the same height. So there is no change in the potential energy also. So Z2 would be equal to Z1. So Z2 minus Z1 is also zero. So now in this particular equation, so this term goes away. Z1g and Z2g are same. So they vanish. This dq by zm is becomes zero. And this dwx by dm also becomes zero. Now in a big equation, all these terms are neglected. Okay, so for a perfectly insulated nozzle, these terms can be neglected. And I have told you that this velocity at the exit is greater than the velocity at the inlet. That means the still air, the still surrounding air that is entering into the nozzle. So it does not have much velocity, whatever may be the speed of the wind, the breeze, or whatever it is there in the surrounding, that would be the velocity of air. Okay, now that is entering into the nozzle and that is coming out with a very higher velocity. So because V2 is greater than V1, what about the kinetic energy V2 squared? That will be very much greater than V1 squared. So you can skip the kinetic energy of V1 squared at the phase of V2 squared. When compared to V2 squared, V1 squared is very, very small. So V1 squared can be neglected. So this guy, this V1 squared by 2, this guy can also be neglected. So you can neglect this also. So you'll end up getting V2 squared by 2 equal to H2 minus H1. Or V2 is 2 times root of 2 times H1 minus H2. So that is the velocity at the exit of the nozzle. Why we are very much concerned about the velocity at the exit of the nozzle? That is the purpose of a nozzle. I want higher velocity at the exit of the nozzle. And I want to find out what is the velocity at the exit of the nozzle if I use such a condition of a nozzle. Okay, so that is your V2 equal to root of 2 times H1 minus H2. So that is your nozzle. Okay, and as I already told you, inverted form of nozzle is your diffuser. So you have a diffuser like this. So in a diffuser, what happens is it comes in with a higher velocity. The velocity is very high. V1 is greater than V2. In a diffuser, what happens is the kinetic energy is reduced and the pressure is increased. So you increase the pressure at the cost of kinetic energy. So in this case, V1 is greater than V2, which means V1 squared is very much greater than V2 squared. V1 squared is very much greater than V2 squared. So in this case, V2 can be neglected. So if you look at this, the same condition of you applies for diffuser as well. I have perfectly insulated the diffuser, which means dq by dm is equal to 0. There is no shaft work here, so dwx by dm is also equal to 0. And you can see that the entry and the exit are at the same height with reference to the ground level. So Z2 minus Z1 is also equal to 0. So the same equation, if you apply to diffuser also, these four terms will go off. The only difference is here V1 squared is greater than V2 squared. So this V2 squared can be neglected in case of a diffuser. Okay. So H1 plus V1 squared by 2 is equal to. So V1 is root of 2 times H2 minus H1. So that is your diffuser. Okay. So in diffuser, we are worried about the velocity at the inlet. In nozzle, we are worried about the velocity at the exit. So sometimes what they do is they ask you to derive the steady flow energy equation and apply it for nozzle. So that can be the question. So which means you have to derive the equation and then you have to apply this condition and show that V2 is equal to root of 2 times H1 minus H2. Sometimes they ask in that way also. Okay, so this is for a nozzle and a diffuser. Then there is something called a throttling device. A throttling device is where you allow the flow of the fluid. It is like, it's like a tap. Some amount of fluid will entering in. You can control the flow of the fluid. So in such a device, there is no heat transfer and there is no shaft work also. Okay, so and the velocity can also be neglected. Why the velocity can also be neglected is in a throttling device, we use a throttling device usually in case of refrigerators, okay, where we use that throttling device to bring down the pressure. Okay, the pressure is brought low by using a capillary tube. Capillary tube is a very lengthy tube, okay, and you will have the movement of the fluid in a very slow manner. So at the entry of the capillary tube, you'll have the same velocity, and at the exit also you will have the same velocity, but the flow, the velocity will be very, very slow. Okay. We do that so that the pressure gets reduced. Okay. We are not lowering the pressure as in the case of cylinder piston arrangement by the expansion of gases inside the cylinder. That is not how we reduce the pressure. In this case, we are reducing the pressure by allowing the fluid to to flow in a very slow manner. Okay, so when we do that, the kinetic energy can also be neglected. And the potential energy is also neglected if it is kept in a horizontal position. So if that is the case, then you will simply have H1 equal to H2. Because the heat transfer is zero, because the work shaft work is zero, there is no change in the potential energy and the kinetic energy, you end up getting H1 equal to H2. So a throttling device is also a device which involves an isenthalpic process. So where your enthalpy is constant. Okay, you won't get problems from this isenthalpic process. But very rarely you may get a 2-mark question over here. Okay, so this is an isenthalpic process where your H remains constant. So there is no change in the value of H. That is your throttling device. Okay, so kindly refer to the textbook for a picture, or while sending the presentation, I'll add the picture and send it to you. Okay. Then we have turbine and compressor. We have already taken this example a lot before coming into this particular point. Okay. But anyhow, we will just this should be a compressor. And in a turbine, we have expansion. So turbine should be like this. So both in case of a compressor and a turbine, we can keep it insulated, which means dQ by dm can be kept as zero. Okay, both of them can be kept insulated, both the compressor as well as the turbine. Okay, so your dQ by dm will be zero for both. So you can find dQ by dm equal to zero. And you can look at the level of the entry and exit, both in case of compressor and turbine. So both of them are at the same level. So Z2 minus Z1 is also equal to zero. Okay, when you take the change in the kinetic energy, that is also zero. If you remember this example, when I told you, I said it is entering with lower velocity, and in the impeller it is achieving higher velocity, but then you have a diffuser. In that diffuser, whatever velocity it has achieved, that is getting converted into higher pressure, and then you have an outer casing for this. Okay, and it will be further reduced, the velocity will be further reduced, and when it goes out, it goes out with the normal velocity with which it has entered in. So at the entry and the exit, you will have the same velocity. So the change in kinetic energy is also equal to zero in case of both compressor as well as the turbine. So if that is the case, then we have only this. H1 is equal to H2 plus dWx by dm. Why do you have this dWx by dm? In case of a compressor, you have a motor connected to the compressor. So only when the motor rotates, the shaft rotates and then the compressor rotates. So you have shaft work in the form of input. In case of turbine, you have shaft work in the form of output. So that is why for a turbine, this is plus dWx by dm, because it is work output. Okay, so your work output would be H1 minus H2. Wx by m is equal to H1 minus H2. So you can see that the work transfer is simply the difference in enthalpy. This is what you will be doing in the next semester. In the next semester, you will be dealing with steam turbines and gas turbines. And you will find that the work transfer is simply the difference in the enthalpies. The only thing that you will have to do, is identify the enthalpy values from the steam tables in case of a steam turbine. And in case of a gas turbine, you will have to use some efficiency formula to identify the real enthalpy values. Okay, so that is your turbine. If you take compressor, for the compressor, work input is negative. So you have, so instead of plus here, plus dWx by dm, here you have minus dWx by dm. Or in the algebraic form, it is simply Wx by m. So Wx by m is simply h2 minus h1. So for the compressor, work is input, and for the turbine, the work transfer is work output. Okay, and you can find in both the cases, the work transfer is the difference in enthalpies. Then we have something called a heat exchanger. Okay, this device you will be studying later on in heat transfer, maybe in the fifth semester or sixth semester. This device, what it does is, the usual example people take is a shell and tube heat exchanger or any form of heat exchanger. What it does is, okay, let's take a heat exchanger. I'm talking about a very simple heat exchanger. Okay, you have an entry here for this rectangular shell. Okay, here I'm going to have a cold fluid flowing outside the pipe. Okay, and then inside I have got a pipe where I allow the hot fluid to flow through. Okay, here I have hot fluid, outside I have got cold fluid. What happens is the hot fluid will transfer its heat energy to the cold fluid. Okay, so when the hot fluid goes out, it goes with lesser heat. And when the cold fluid goes out, it goes with more heat than which it has entered in. Okay, so it came with less heat and it goes out with more heat. In the pipe, it is coming with more heat and it is going with lesser heat. Okay, and in a heat exchanger, what happens is the heat energy of the hot fluid is transferred to the heat energy of the cold fluid. Such a thermodynamic device is called as heat exchanger. What we are interested here is this hot fluid is entering in with a mass flow rate, say m dot h. And we have assumed that this mass flow rate at the entry and exit for the hot fluid is the same. There is no change in the mass flow rate at the entry and the exit. Okay. And the enthalpy with which it has entered in is h1 for the hot fluid. And with the enthalpy with which it is going out is H2 for the hot fluid. For the cold fluid, we take the mass flow rate as m dot c, and we take the enthalpy as H3 at the inlet. At the exit also, the mass flow rate does not change, so it is m dot c, and the enthalpy here is H4. Okay, so now when we do a simple energy balance, the energy at the inlet is equal to energy at the exit. So what is the energy at the inlet? M dot H into H1 plus M dot C into H3. That is the energy at the inlet. Energy at the exit, M dot H into H2 plus M dot C into H4. That is the energy at the exit. And if we rearrange the mass flow rate of the hot fluid terms on one side, so you will have m dot h into h1 minus h2 plus m dot c into h4 minus h3. A very simple energy balance. And you will be doing this a little bit elaborately in your heat and mass transfer subject. But now you can simply note down the energy balance that you have for a heat exchanger. Okay. So this is for a heat exchanger. So these are some of the thermodynamic devices for which we have applied the first law of thermodynamics. Okay, so this is how the first law of thermodynamics is applied to some of the thermodynamic devices. Air flows steadily at the rate of 0.5 kilogram per second through an air compressor entering at 7 meter per second velocity, 100 kilopascal pressure, and 0.95 meter cube per kilogram volume, and leaving at 5 meter per second, 700 kilopascal, and 0.19 meter cube per kilogram. The internal energy of air leaving is 90 kilojoule per kilogram, greater than that of air entering. cooling water in the compressor jacket absorbs heat from the air at the rate of 58 kilowatt. Compute the rate of shaft work input to the air in kilowatt. So they want us to find WS. Find the ratio of inlet pipe diameter to outlet pipe diameter. So D1 by D2, they are asking us to find out. So what are all the given details? If you look at the given details, M dot is given to us. M dot is 0.5 kilogram per second. And they have given you the velocity at the inlet is 7 meter per second. The inlet pressure is 100 kilopascal. And the specific volume at the inlet is small V1, which is 0.95 meter cube per kilogram. And you can look at the exit velocity, which is V2. 700 kilopascal is the exit pressure, which is P2. And you can see the specific volume at the exit is 0.19 meter cube per kilogram, which is small V2. And they are saying energy of air leaving is greater than the energy of air entering. So what they are saying is U2 minus U1 is equal to 90 kilojoule per kilogram. So energy of air leaving is 90 kilojoule per kilogram greater than the energy of air that is entering. So that is your U2 minus U1. Then cooling water in the compressor jacket absorbs heat from air. Okay, so which means heat is leaving the compressor and that is absorbed by some water in the cooling jacket. So that is heat leaving the system. And that is given as 58 kilowatt. So how they have given it is dQ by dt, because they have said it as watt. So which means 58 kilowatt. 58 kilowatt is 58 kilojoule per second. So 1 watt is equal to 1 joule per second. So because they have said it as kilowatt, this watt is nothing but kilo joule per second. Okay, so that these are all the given details. Now they want us to find the rate of shaft work input in kilowatt, which means they are asking us to find out dW by dt, which is nothing but dWx by dt. That is the term which we have used in the derivation. We can simply use dW by dt also. Okay, and they want us to find the ratio of the inlet pipe diameter to the outlet pipe diameter. So that is D1 by D2. Okay, so these are the two terms they are asking us to find out. See, this is very, very simple. Sometimes they ask this question in the 11 marks also. Okay, but the only problem here is you can make mistakes while substituting the values and computing the values. You will be substituting the values correct, but sometimes you end up getting wrong answer because of the calculation part. Okay, so as per the equation, what we have here is m dot into U1 plus P1V1 plus V1 squared by 2 plus G is at 1 plus dq by dt equal to m dot 2 u2 plus p2 v2 plus v2 squared by 2 plus g is it to plus dw by dt. This is the equation. Okay, the first law of thermodynamics applied to the open system. Now we have to substitute the values, that's all. So for m dot we have 0.5. Okay, so before proceeding further, what is required is dw by dt. So you can bring all the other terms to the left hand side. So what you can have is u1 minus u2. Okay, so u1 minus u2, u2 minus u1 is 90 kilojoule per kilogram. So now what you will have is minus u1 minus u2. Okay, so you will get minus 90 for u1 minus u2. Don't forget to put this 10 to the power 3 because it is in kilojoule per kilogram. Okay, plus p1 v1 minus p2 v2. P1 is how much? 100 kilopascal. Don't forget to multiply it by 10 to the power 3. So this is 100 pascal. And the inlet velocity is 7. Minus 500 into 10 to the power 3. Sorry, 700, right? 700 into 10 to the power 3. See, I myself have made a mistake and you guys are also remaining silent. P1 V1, V1 is specific volume, right? So in, this is not 7, this is supposed to be 0.95. Okay, this is 0.95. It is specific volume at the inlet. It is not velocity. You have to be careful here while substituting. 700 into 10 to the power 3 into 0.19. So capital V is velocity, small v is specific volume. Don't make a mistake here. See, while substituting, I myself have made a mistake. So you have to be very careful here. So this is 0.95. And nothing is said about the potential energy, which means GZ1 minus Z2 can be neglected. Okay, but kinetic energy is given. So that is 7 squared minus 5 squared divided by 2. dq by dt is, it's actually work leaving the system. So this is minus 58 kilowatt. So this would be minus 58 into 10 to the power 3. And now if you solve this, you will get the value of dw by dt. My question to you is this. Now that we have done this, this U1 minus U2 is in joules per kilogram. Outside you have got a kilogram, so this kilogram will get cancelled, so you will get, because outside you have got this kilogram, m dot is in kilogram, U1 minus U2 you have joule plus kilogram. If you take P1V1 is Newton per meter squared into meter cube plus meter cube per kilogram. And if you look at the next term, it is simply meter squared per second squared. And if you have potential energy, you will have meter into meter per second squared. That is also meter squared per second squared. My question to you is this. I have all these terms in different units. Are they all the same or are they all different? Should we introduce some correction factors or something? You guys should tell me. Are they all the same? Or should we introduce some correction factors here?
Sir, as it's a balanced equation, maybe.
As it is?
A balanced energy
equation. They're all same.
The units will be not a problem.
My question is whether it is balanced.
Yes, sir. It's balanced.
How do you say meter squared per second squared is equivalent to joules? Are you confident about that?
Left hand side and right hand side are equal, so that's why the units will also be balanced.
No, units should be balanced. My question is, are the units balanced? In an equation, the units should be balanced. We know that the unit should be balanced. Only then it is an equation. It's a proper equation. My question is meter squared per second squared equivalent to joule? Can we prove that? It's very simple.
Yes, actually, we can write the joule is nothing but energy, which is force into...
Yes.
The force into distance, we can write it as the work or energy. So, force is nothing but a Newton, and distance we can write in meter. And rearranging Newton as kgms minus 2 and into meter. So, that becomes kg m square a square. So, we have kg in the denominator. So, it becomes equal.
Okay, just like he said, I can write joule. Joule can be written as Newton meter. Okay, and Newton is nothing but force, unit of force. Force is mass into acceleration, so kilogram into meter per second squared, and I have a meter outside. So you will end up getting kilogram meter squared per second squared for joule. Okay, and you have joule per kilogram, so your kilogram... Your kilogram and kilogram will get cancelled. Okay. Let's check this. So joule is in Newton per meter. Newton meter is joule. Energy is, work is force into displacement. What about the next term? P1V1 is Newton per meter squared. And then you have meter cube per kilogram. Okay, so you will end up getting Newton meter per kilogram. So once again, this Newton can be replaced with new kilogram, meter per second squared. So you'll end up getting meter squared per second squared. So that is correct. Okay, so here you have joule per kilogram. So here also you have joule per kilogram. Correct. Okay, so you can have this meter squared per second squared is equivalent to joule per kilogram, or this meter squared per second squared is equivalent to your product of pressure into specific volume. Okay, so sometimes in your textbook, what they would do is they will be substituting directly in kilojoules here. So instead of 10 power 3, they will simply write it as 90. Instead of kilopascal 10 to the power 3, simply they will write it as 100, simply as 700. Okay. If that is the case, then here you should multiply it with 10 to the power minus 3. If you are substituting everywhere in kilojoule, then for this particular velocity term and the potential energy term, if it is available, you have to multiply it with 10 to the power minus 3. Or to avoid confusion, you can always write everything in proper units. You can write them in joules. You can write them instead of kilojoule and kilowatt, you can simply write them in joule and watt. If that is the thing, then it will be very easy for you. Okay. So if can you guys solve this and get the answer? If you solve and get the answer, you can check it here. So for this particular problem, dW by dt happens to be minus 122 kilowatt. Are you getting that? Because there are multiple terms inside the brackets, usually students make mistakes here. The substitution, even the substitution, most of them will do it correctly, but the final answer, they will not end up getting the same answer. They will make some simple mistakes here and there, and so the final answer will be wrong. So the thing is, you have, it is better that you do terms separately. Find out P1 V1 minus P2 V2. Get a value for it, write it down separately. V1 squared minus V2 squared by 2, get the value for it and write it down separately. Because when you write it in a single step, then the step marks cannot be awarded if you are writing it as a single step. If you write them separately, maybe if one thing is wrong, the rest we can identify where you have made the mistake and marks can be awarded accordingly. Okay, so it is always a good practice to write the terms separately and then rearrange them and get the final answer. Okay. The second part of the question is ratio of the inlet diameter to the outer diameter. Okay, so here we are using something called the mass flow rate formula. So mass flow rate formula is rho A1, A1, V1, rho AV, or we can use AV by V, A into velocity, area into velocity divided by the specific volume. So here we are using that A1 V1 by small V1 equal to A2 V2 by small V2. What we require is D1 by D2. So we take A1 by A2 equal to V2 by V1 velocity into V1 by V2 specific volume. So that A1 by A2 can be written as pi by 4 D1 squared by pi by 4 D2 squared. So D1 by D2 will be root of 3.57. So we end up getting 1.89. Okay, so the ratio of the inlet diameter to the exit diameter is 1.89. Okay, so dW by dt is minus 122 kilowatt. D1 by D2 is 1.89. Okay, so that is what we get for this particular problem. So, example 2, in a steady flow apparatus, 135 kilojoule of work is done by each kg of fluid. Specific volume of the fluid, pressure and velocity at the inlet are 0.37 meter cube per kilogram, 600 kilopascal and 16 meter per second. The inlet is 32 meter above the floor and discharges at the floor level. So here they have given Z2 and Z1. Z1 is 32 meter above the ground. Z2 is zero. It is at the floor level. Okay, so Z1 is 32 meter. Z2 is zero. The discharge conditions, they have given you the specific volume, pressure, and the velocity, 270 meter per second. The total heat loss between the inlet and the discharge is 9 kilojoule per kilogram of fluid. And flowing through this apparatus, does the specific internal energy increase or decrease, and by how much? Okay, so this is the question. So here they have given the work done. Work is done, so which means it is positive. Okay, and they have given 135 kilojoule by each kg of fluid, which means it is 135 kilojoule per kilogram. Okay, they have given 135 kilojoule per kilogram. The specific volume is small V1. The pressure is 600 kilopascal. And the velocity is 16 meter per second. So here they have given 32 meter, which is also Z1. And here specific volume V2, pressure P2, and velocity V2. These three are given. So V2, P2, and velocity V2. That is also given. And the total heat loss, when they say heat loss, it is minus 9 kilojoule per kilogram. So Q here is, because they have said it as loss, it is minus 9 kilojoule per kilogram. Okay, so now they want us to find the change in the internal energy. They want us to find delta U, specific internal energy. So delta small u, they are asking us to find out this. So this is actually small q and small w, because it is in kilojoule per kilogram. So small q and small w. Okay, so you have to write the same equation. Here everything is in, they have not given the mass flow rate. So here it is in per mass basis. So you can simply write it as U1 plus P1 V1 plus V1 squared by 2 plus Z1 plus D plus DQ by DM is equal to U2 plus P2 V2 plus Z2 into G plus V2 squared by 2 plus dW by dm, because it is in per mass basis. You can use that equation. Okay, and you can rearrange the equation because they want us to find the change in the internal energy. So U1 minus U2 is the formula. You can also write it as U2 minus U1. Either way, you can solve it. So U1 minus U2 is, so if you rearrange the equation, you get P2 V2 minus P1 V1 plus V2 squared minus V1 squared by 2 plus Z2 minus Z1 into G plus dWx by dm minus dq by dm. And you have to carefully substitute the values. Always substitute for kilopascal. Don't forget to multiply it by 10 to the power 3. So the final pressure is 100 kilopascal, so I simply written it as 10 to the power 5. The initial pressure is 600 into 10 to the power 3, that is 600 kilopascal. Okay, and I have substituted the value for the kinetic energy term also. For the potential energy term, see, I have substituted, just a minute. The inlet is 32 meter above the ground. So this should be 0 minus 32. Z2 is 0. Z1 is 32. So this should be 0 minus 32 into 9.81. dw by dx, sorry, dwx by dm, that is 135 kilojoule. And heat loss they have given. So heat loss should be subtracted here. Minus of minus 9 will be plus 9. So we have written it as plus 9. Okay. So you end up getting 20.14 kilojoule. So that is u1 minus u2. So in this case, actually, the specific internal energy, has it increased or decreased? What do you infer from that?
Decreased.
The specific internal energy has?
Decreased.
It has decreased actually. U1 minus U2. We have written initial state minus final state. So the initial state is greater than the final state, which means the specific internal energy has actually decreased. Okay. So you have to be careful while writing it. If you would have written U2 minus U1, then it will be very clear whether it has increased or decreased. But because we have written it as U1 minus U2, then even the positive entity, you have to understand that the initial specific internal energy is greater than the final specific internal energy. So the internal energy, specific internal energy has actually decreased.
Okay. So then the unit should be kilojoule per kilogram, no, sir?
Yes, the unit should be kilojoule per kilogram.
Okay.
That is a mistake here. So the unit should be kilojoule per kilogram. Correct. Good observation. Okay. From my previous experience, what I find is the students will be able to substitute the values very correctly, but they won't be getting this 20.14. They'll be getting something like 37 or sometimes even 400, something like that they will get, which means they have made some mathematical error while solving the problem. It is simple addition, subtraction, multiplication, but a couple of terms are involved. So you have to be a little bit careful while solving open systems problem. Okay. And my advice is, if you can split and write it as different steps, then even if you make a mistake, you will not end up getting very less marks. You may get at least the step marks for the problem. Okay. So example number 3. In a steam power station, steam flows steadily through a 0.2 meter diameter pipeline from boiler to the turbine. At the boiler end, the steam conditions are found to be pressure, temperature, enthalpy, and specific volume is given. At the turbine end, the conditions are found to be this much. There is a heat loss of 8.5 kilojoule per kilogram from the pipeline. Calculate the steam flow rate. Okay. So what is given here is, on one end, you have got boiler. Okay. And from the boiler, there is a pipeline which carries steam to something called a turbine. So you have a turbine here, you have a boiler here, and steam flows from boiler to the turbine through the pipeline. And the condition at the boiler end is given, the condition at the turbine end is given. They want us to find the steam flow rate. Okay. Now, what is the system? Which is the system boundary? Should I consider the boiler, turbine, and the pipeline? Or should I consider boiler alone and turbine alone? Which should be my system?
The pipe and the turbine, sir.
The pipe and the turbine. Why not the boiler?
Actually, they have mentioned only at the end of the boiler, so we can consider only the pipe and the turbine. But even if we consider the pipe and turbine, it is simply considering the turbine only, no, sir.
The keyword here is there is a heat loss of 8.5 kilojoule per kilogram from the pipeline. Okay, so here what they are talking about is neither the boiler nor the turbine. They are talking about the pipeline alone. So our boundary exists only in the pipeline. Okay, so when they are saying boiler end and turbine end, it is not at the end of the turbine or at the end of the boiler. They are talking about the end of the pipeline near the boiler, the end of the pipeline near the turbine. So that is what they mean when they say at the boiler end and at the turbine end. Okay, so at the inlet of the pipe, the inlet of the pipe is called the boiler end, the exit of the pipe is called as the turbine end. Okay, so that should be taken as P1, T1, H1 and small v1. And similarly, you should take this as P2, T2, H2 and small v2. So that is a heat loss from the pipeline. So you have Q equal to minus 8.5 kilojoule per kilogram because it is a heat loss. And because it is a pipeline, do you have any work here? I mean shaft work. Is there any shaft work here? There is no shaft work here in a pipeline. Okay. So shaft work is zero in this particular case. And they want us to find the steam flow rate. So here they have given the value of enthalpy directly. So it will be H1 plus, and nothing is said about the velocity. So if nothing is said about the velocity, then the velocity is negligible. Okay. Have they said about the velocity? Have they said about the velocity?
No, sir.
But can the velocity differ here? Can the velocity differ here? Obviously, it will differ. Why? Why? Because the specific volume is different at the entry and the exit. They have given you 0.2 diameter for the area. So we know that m dot is equal to a1 v1, which is the velocity, divided by the specific volume v1. Okay, because they have said steam flows steadily, because of this keyword, we know that this can be equated to, so this is m dot 1. Because they say steam flows steadily, m dot 1 is equal to m dot 2, which means a1 v1 by small v1, a1 v1 by small v1 equal to a2 v2 by small v2. The area is not going to change because the pipeline everywhere the diameter is 0.2 meter, so you can cancel out this area. Okay, and what you will have is v2 is equal to small v2 by small v1 into capital v1. So small v2 happens to be 0.084, v1 is 0.073, and so you will have 0.084. And small v1 is 0.06. 7, 3 times velocity v1, because nothing is mentioned about the velocity. And I think 0.084 by 0.073. How much is this? Is this 1.5? Check it. 1.15. The book answer is 1.15 V1. Okay, that is your V2. And because it is a pipeline and because it is connecting the boiler and the turbine, so nothing is said about the level of the pipe. So we can assume that to be at the same level. Okay, so when we write the equation, we can write this as H1 plus V1 squared by 2 plus dQ by dm. Nothing is said about the level, so you can skip the potential energy term, is equal to H2 plus V2 squared by 2 plus, do we have anything else? Plus dW by dm would be there, but that is not there because there is no work done here. Okay. So now you can substitute the value of H1. H1 is given to you in the problem. V1, you can retain it as such. dQ by dm is 8.5 into 10 to the power 3. H2 is given to you. You can substitute it. V2 squared, you can write it as 1.15 V1 squared by 2. So from this equation, you will be able to get the value of V1. If you substitute V2 in terms of V1, you will get the value of V1. And from that, you will be able to get the value of V2 also. You can get the value of V2. You can get the value of V2 also. You can get the value of V2 also. Okay. So once you know the values of V1 and V2, you can use, or simply by knowing the value of V1 alone, you can use the formula m dot equal to a1 v1 by small v1 to get the value of the mass flow rate. Okay. So if you try and solve, I haven't written the solution for this particular problem. So according to the book, V1 happens to be 125.1 meter per second. So the velocity here is 125.1 meter per second. So that is the velocity at the inlet, and your mass flow rate, that is the question actually, the mass flow rate happens to be 53.8 kilogram per second. 53.8 kilogram per second.